Hi, I'm Jeff Rechtemold. I'm on the leadership team here at Red Cedar, and I want to welcome you to church this morning in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. He's the one that brought us here, and we're here to spend our time united together to bring worship and praise to His name, and to renew our hearts towards His purpose. If you're new, I want to welcome you to our church. We're glad that God has brought you here, and we hope that you will join us when we return to physically meeting at church. Let me start off this morning in the book of James. James tells us that every good thing, every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, in whom there is no variation or shifting shadow. And in the exercise of his will, he brought us by the word of truth, so that we would be, as it were, the first fruits of his creation. Welcome. Please join together as we sing.
Will you join me in singing Holy, Holy, Holy?
Story, God Sends Help. Jesus' friends and helpers huddled together in a stuffy upstairs room. Even though it was sunny outside, the shutters were closed, the door was locked. Wait in Jerusalem, Jesus had told them. I'm going to send you a special present. God's power is going to come into you. God's Holy Spirit is coming. So here they were, waiting. Actually, mostly what they were doing was just being scared and hiding. You can't blame them. Their best friend had left. The important people and leaders were after them. And Jesus had given them a job they didn't know how to do. As they waited, they were praying and remembering. Remembering how, from the beginning, God had been working out his secret rescue plan. Suddenly, a strong wind filled the little room, whistling through the walls, rustling the straw on the floor. And there, on everyone's heads, shining in the gloom, were flickering flames. Fire that didn't hurt or burn. And something more inside, in their hearts, they felt a strange heat, almost as if all the coldness and hardness were melting away. And as if their broken hearts were mending. And God was giving them a brand new hearts that could work properly. How it happened, they didn't know. But they knew that God's power had struck their hearts ablaze, and Jesus himself was coming to live inside them. They had seen Jesus go away, but now he was closer than he had ever been, inside their hearts. And this time, nothing could ever separate them. Jesus could always be there. Jesus would always be there. With them, loving them, whispering the promise that would get rid of the poison and the terrible lie and the sickness in their hearts. Wonderful, God's wonderful promise to them, you are my child and I love you. Make your home in me as I make my home in you, Jesus had said. Could it be heaven was coming into their hearts? They threw open the shutters. Sunlight flooded their room as love had flooded their hearts. And the little room was filled with happy noises, dancing feet, singing and laughing. They unlocked the door and surged into the streets as if they had never been afraid. Peter spoke in a loud voice so everyone could hear. Jesus died for you, he said, because he loves you. But God made him alive again. He had rescued you. He has rescued you. People stopped and listened. The words sank down into their hearts and worked like medicine that makes you well. Like the antidote to a deadly poison, like a kiss that wakes you from a deep sleep. Stop running away from God, Peter said. Run to him instead, so he can love you and make you free. And Peter told them the wonderful story of God's love, God's never stopping, never giving up, unbreaking, always and forever love, how Jesus had come and all that had happened. There were lots of people from faraway countries in Jerusalem. They couldn't speak the same language, but as they listened to Peter, everyone could understand what he was saying in their own languages. Many people believed and became Jesus' new friends and helpers. And the wonderful news of Jesus spread like sparks from a fire to villages, towns, and city. Every day, more and more people believed. And so it was that the family of God's children, his special people, grew. One man was watching. I'll stop this, Saul said, but this was God's plan, and nothing in the world would ever be able to stop it. And I will pray. Dear God, we are thankful that you do have a rescue plan for us, and we're thankful for this story and the faith of the disciples, and we just pray that you help us to build faith like they had. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
One of the reasons that we join together as believers is to remind ourselves and to reaffirm what we believe. One way we do that at Red Cedar is by reading through the New City Catechism. Last week, we answered the important question, Will God allow sin and idolatry to go unpunished? The answer was a resounding no. In the video, Alistair Begg discussed the theology of God's judgment, the idea that our sins, and most importantly, our rejection of God as King of our lives, will be punished with an ultimate judgment. And if the story ended there, the Christian faith would be a very empty faith. But it didn't end there. And so today we ask the next question. Is there any way to escape the punishment and be brought into God's favor?
You know, the great news of the gospel is that God Himself has paid the penalty for our separation from Him. There's a startling but amazing verse in Isaiah chapter 53, verse 6, that says, "All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned each one to his own way. But the Lord has placed on Him the iniquity of us all." What a remarkable statement that is. It's coupled with 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, when it says that God has made His Son, the Lord Jesus, who knew no sin, to be sin for us, in order that we might be made the righteousness of God in Him. That is incredible news. We're separated from Him. We were the objects of His wrath, and God turned that away to His own Son who paid the price for our sin. That's the heart of the gospel.
Please read the answer with me. Yes, to satisfy His justice, God Himself, out of mere mercy, reconciles us to Himself and delivers us from sin and from the punishment for sin by a Redeemer. In Christian circles and in church, we often use the word the gospel. We might use it to refer to a book of the Bible or in general to Jesus' life. But the word gospel inherently means good news. And it's used to refer to the fact that though we were to be punished by God, God sent a Redeemer to remove the punishment, to restore our relationship with Him, and to bring us into His blessing. What a marvelous thing that is. This morning as we pray, I would like to pray through Psalm 23. Psalm 23 is a familiar psalm, and so I hope that this will be a blessing to you, both now and throughout the week. Let's go ahead and pray. God, You are our shepherd. You provide for all of our needs. You provide us with green pastures and with still waters. You feed us, give us safety, and allow our spirit to rest in Your goodness rather than living in constant worry or fear. You, O God, are our comfort. You lead us in righteousness, in serving Your eternal purpose for Your sake. Even if danger surrounds us, both from without or within, we don't have to fear because You protect us. You convict us, and You lead us in Your paths. And far from that conviction being a burden, it's a comfort, knowing that in Your goodness, You discipline us as a loving Father. You provide so much peace and comfort and security that even in the presence of enemies and danger, I can feast in Your name. You bless me more than I deserve, and more than I could ever imagine. Because of Your presence in my life and Your promises, I know You will walk with me in goodness and in mercy, and will lead me into the waiting arms of my Savior Jesus Christ, with whom I will spend all of eternity. To Him be glory and blessing and honor forever. Amen.
Let's join our voices together to sing of what God has done and what He will do. One day when heaven was filled with His praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is He. The Word became flesh and the light shined among us, His glory revealed. Living He loved me, dying He saved me.
sins far away. Rising, he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day they led him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering, anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. The hands that healed nations stretched out on a tree and took the nails for me. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day the grave could conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then he arose over death he had conquered. Now is ascended, my Lord, evermore. Death cannot hold him, the grave cannot keep him from rising again. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. Far away, rising, he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day.
Romans 12:14. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everybody. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, "It is mine to avenge. I will repay," says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Everyone must submit himself to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. Consequently, he who rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted, and those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers hold no terror for those who do right, but for those who do wrong. Do you want to be free from the fear of the one in authority? Then do what is right, and he will commend you. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword for nothing. He is God's servant, an agent of wrath to bring punishment on the wrongdoer. Therefore, it is necessary to submit to the authorities, not only because of possible punishment, but also because of conscience.
Good morning, Red Cedar, and friends of Red Cedar. It's great to be together again. And this particular Sunday, we're going to do something a little different. So I wanted to start off by explaining that. And we're going to invite you during this message to send in a question. And then we'll have a Zoom session that you can click on after the sermon. You can send in your questions in the same way that you went to the website, clicked on the service today, and it began. If you scroll below that, you'll see a place where you can enter a question. So let me encourage you to do that, and Lord willing, we'll try to answer those questions afterwards. Let me pray for us now as we get into God's Word. Father, we are grateful that you speak, because this is a time when we need to hear your voice. Every day we need to, but we sense it even more in this strange, uncharted space of history that we find ourselves in. So speak now, I pray. Speak words of conviction, of comfort. Only you know what each heart needs that listens. So we come to you confidently in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, those of you who know me know that I am not a fan of church marquees. For that matter, I'm not a fan of Christian bumper stickers or Christian billboards. But I want you to imagine that you were driving by Red Cedar, and you came across this particular marquee. My guess is that you wouldn't be too excited about attending, perhaps, this morning. And particularly because that seems to fly in the face of some things that are going on right now in our culture. In fact, when I thought about this message this morning, all I could think of was a line from a Monty Python movie, "Run away, run away." But you have to understand something. We began a journey through the book of Romans almost 7 months ago now. And many, many months ago, I had outlined where we would be on each particular Sunday. And it just so happens that this Sunday, we're on Romans 13, and that marquee is actually a quote from Romans chapter 13. So before we jump into the controversy of that quote, I think it'd be best to take a step back and ask, how did we get here to this point of Romans 13? The book of Romans, of course, is all about grace. This book in the Bible called Romans, a letter written from the Apostle Paul to a group of brand new Christians in the city of Rome, is all about grace, and we're spelling grace with an extra R here. G stands for God, R for reigning, R for righteousness, and A-C-E at Christ's expense. The book of Romans is all about God's reigning righteousness at Christ's expense. The book starts out by telling us that all of us, whether we're religious or not, are unrighteous. We're unable to earn a righteousness of our own. We need to be given a righteousness, but that righteousness that's given to us is costly. It cost Christ. It was his death and his resurrection that we celebrated a couple weeks ago
that made this righteousness possible. But that righteousness that God gives to us, he declares us who are unrighteous righteous when we give our lives to Jesus. But he does more than just give us a new status and a new identity. That righteousness is a power reigning inside of us, making us into someone as beautiful as Jesus is. So that's what the book of Romans is all about. And now we find ourselves at a place in the book of Romans, chapters 12 through 16. We've been hearing all about what grace is. Now we need to know, what does grace look like? And chapters 12 through 16 really pivot off of two verses at the beginning of Romans chapter 12. Let me just read those two verses again to you. I appeal to you, therefore, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. So a simple way of describing the verses I just read as kind of an umbrella that goes over all four of these chapters is this: living as a daily sacrifice to God makes love real and the church one. That's really the sort of banner theme that's going to be over these four chapters. Living as a daily sacrifice to God makes love real and the church one. And so we see right off the bat, the first few verses after those, the two I just read in verses 3 through 8, grace makes us more important than me. And then in verses 9 through 13, grace makes love real. And that brings us to the section that we're going to look at today, which starts with the end of chapter 12 and goes into the beginning of chapter 13, where that controversial verse is on the marquee, by the way. And I would title this section that starts in verse 14 of chapter 12 and goes all the way to verse 10 of chapter 13, that grace makes room for love to overcome injustice. Grace makes room for love to overcome injustice. And the first thing we see here in this passage before us today, it makes room for love to overcome injustice by keeping us low. What do I mean by that? Well, I'll tell you what, even before I tell you that, we need to stop and define something else in this passage, or I think we'll really get off the mark from the get-go. And it's found in verse 20 of chapter 12. It says, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. And so here's the question, and it's an important question. In fact, you'll hear this question at the end of the message. Who is my enemy? What does the Bible mean when it speaks about our enemy? Well, verse 14 gives us a little bit of a clue. It says, bless those who persecute you. So my enemy is someone who's persecuting me. You could say an enemy is someone who comes between you and God. It's someone who makes it hard for you to follow God. And I want to continue to expand this because I'm convinced that we will minimize the depth of this chapter if we don't understand who our enemy is. I'm very much inclined to think that we read a verse like this and we define our enemy in a very limited way, so we tend not to have any real big enemies. But in fact, all the implication in this passage is that all of us have some enemies all the time. So let me expand that a little bit. An enemy is someone who makes it hard for you to follow and trust God. An enemy could be anyone who is doing wrong, whether what they're doing affects you or not. An enemy could be someone with power that's using it abusively. An enemy could be someone who opposes you, whether they oppose you justly or unjustly. It could even be someone you perceive as an enemy who's not really an enemy. An enemy could be someone you struggle with resentment toward that person. I'm not talking about temporary resentment. I'm talking about someone where repeatedly over a course of time, it just seems like you resent that person. And even that person could rightfully be called an enemy. So some enemies you might discover are some people that could be very close to you at times. So understanding who our enemy is, let's go back to this idea here. Grace makes room by keeping us low. I want you to notice something here. Two verses at the beginning and kind of end of this chapter. Verse 3, "For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think." Now notice the exact same thought is down in verse 16. "Don't be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Never be wise in your own sight." Here's the point that I think is being made by these two verses that enclose so much of chapter 12 here. Because the righteousness that we have been given, because that righteousness has been given to us and not earned, it keeps us broken and not boastful. That's what I mean by grace keeps us low. It reminds us that we are right with God, not because of anything we've done, but because of something God has done to his Son. And that keeps us broken, seeing ourselves as the same as every other human being and not above another human being. It keeps us from being boastful. When we live like Romans 12, 1 and 2 speaks about, where our lives are constantly being yielded up to God over and over again, that is the perfect soil for real love, this selfless sacrifice, to grow. And when that real love is growing, how we respond to our enemies, perhaps more than anything else in life, reveals Jesus. Because only when we're low can we see ourselves for who we are, God for who he is, and others as they can be, not as they are presently affecting us. Let me just say that again. Only when we're low can we see ourselves for who we really are, God for who he really is, and others for what they can be, not how they're presently affecting us. So the first thing I see in this chapter is that grace keeps us low, and that's a perfect soil for real love to grow and enable us to respond. The second thing that we're going to talk about both this week and next week is that grace makes room for love to overcome injustice by keeping us from playing God, and instead reflecting God by repaying evil with kindness. And secondly, as we'll look at next week, respecting God by respecting authorities. I believe verse 21 connects chapter 12 and chapter 13, that we ought not to read the hard, controversial stuff that we'll talk about next week disconnected from chapter 12. Verse 21, the hinge verse says this: "Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil by good." If I could put it this way, when we repay evil with kindness, that's speaking about how we act in private. And when we respect God by respecting authorities, that's speaking about how we act in public. In other words, you're going to have a very difficult time respecting authorities in public if you are not privately repaying evil with kindness. Instead of playing God, you're going to be, or instead of reflecting God, you're going to be playing God. So let's talk about this week this idea of reflecting God by repaying evil with kindness. Look at verse 17 and 18. "Repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all. If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all." I'm really caught by a couple things here in verse 17 and 18. It says, give thought, And then this phrase in verse 18, if possible. I think both of these two phrases are a way of saying beware. If I can put it this way, verses 17 and 18 speak about our immediate response, our horizontal response to people, our immediate response to people. And I think the way when it says stop and give thought, it's working against our natural instinct to our enemies. It's essentially saying beware of your natural instinct to retaliate. Beware of your impulsiveness to see things from only your point of view. Beware of your tendency to see things only from your limited vision and your limited sight. I think all of those are contained here in these words. Give thought. Don't just react to your enemies, but stop and give thought. Don't just react to your enemies. Try, if possible, to make peace with your enemies. So if 17 and 18 are the horizontal response, where the idea is beware of your natural instincts, then listen to verse 19, which is the vertical idea. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. Only God and those appointed by him can be judge, jury, and executioner. If I could put it this way, only God is pure enough to take vengeance, or those he appoints in that sense. And if you think about it, this is the problem we have when we individually try to take justice into our own hands. When God executes justice, it always comes out of his love and his wisdom. When God acts to punish or judge, it always flows out of his love and wisdom. As a result, when God judges, he squelches evil by either transforming the evildoer or by permanently removing the evildoer. What's interesting is that when we try to take justice on our own, especially individually, it turns out to be vengeance. And whether it's vengeance in the form of illegal violence or even socially acceptable hate, which, by the way, if you notice in verse 14, it says, bless those who persecute you. And what's the opposite of blessing? It's cursing them. Cursing isn't necessarily illegal. It's not even necessarily an act of violence. But it is, in fact, a socially acceptable form of vengeance, if you will. And so our vengeance, unlike God's, doesn't flow out of love and wisdom. Instead of, it says in verse 17, what we're doing is we're repaying evil for evil. So if God's justice flows out of his love and wisdom and squelches evil, human beings, when they try to take justice into their own hands, especially individually here, it actually perpetuates evil. Because we're not simply trying to get even. Vengeance for human beings is getting more than even. Now, there's another great passage that dovetails with this. So I want to read a section of that. It's in Matthew chapter 5. I really think these two passages go together beautifully. It comes from a famous sermon of Jesus's, Matthew 5, verse 38 through 48. So just a short section of this. You've heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist the one who is evil. But if anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if anyone would sue you and take your tunic, let him have your cloak as well. And if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with him 2 miles. Give to the one who begs from you, and do not refuse the one who would borrow from you. So let's think about this for just a moment. When Jesus says, if anyone slaps you on the cheek, turn and give him the other cheek. Now, this is a really easy question. What is the most natural instinct in you when someone slaps you on the cheek? Maybe I'm alone, but for me, it's to find their cheek as fast as I can with my hand. When I connect that passage with the Romans 12 passage, I come to this conclusion. Assume my first response is to my enemy is a wrong response. Again, I think both of these passages warn about the impulsive first reactions that we have. You know, when someone slaps you on the cheek, it not only does it, not only is the natural instinct to slap them back, but it even feels like it's the right thing to do. It just feels like they deserve it. I mean, even more so than you ever deserved the slap that you got. And I'll tell you a very practical area where I see this all the time. I have lost count, and I would say, with no exaggeration, it numbers into the hundreds. I've lost count of the number of times I have walked away from a discussion, in quotes, by the way, with my wife, it's usually called an argument, and found this thought running through my head a few minutes later. Why did I get so defensive? You know, if I could have somehow not gotten defensive, I think that whole discussion would have gone better, it would have ended better. But why is it so natural and instinctive and frequent for me in those situations to get defensive? You might be asking yourself another similar question. Why do I get my feelings hurt so easily? Why is it that sometimes it just seems like, it's easy to get hurt and it's hard to know how to come out of that? I think all of those are ways that our first responses to a situation are usually wrong responses. There is an interesting phrase in Romans chapter 12. Maybe you picked up on it when you heard the scripture reading earlier in the service. It's actually one of those verses, I'm surprised more people don't ask me about it because it really sounds strange. It's in Romans chapter 12, verse 20. If your enemy's hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. Sounds a lot like what Jesus is saying in the Sermon on the Mount. But then it's this phrase, for by so doing, you will heap burning coals on his head. Now that doesn't really sound very nice, does it? What in the world is going on with that phrase? Well, I think there are two possible interpretations, and I think they actually both go together. I don't think one excludes the other, but there's two possible interpretations. The first one is this. When you respond to someone who does you evil with kindness, like they slap you on the face and you don't slap them back, but instead respond with some form of kindness, that reaction is so unnatural, it's so unexpected, and it's so shocking that it's like a bright light shining on the attacker, and that bright light can break that attacker. It can expose their darkness, their shame, their guilt, and they can find themselves on their knees later on, broken by that. That's how that kindness is like burning coals upon their head, melting the darkness in them, if you will. I've heard it said many times that wounded people wound people. Wounded people wound people. You know what grace does? Grace enables me to look past the action. It makes me pause. It makes me look past the action and ask the question, why? Why would a person do this to me? I wonder what's going on in them. And that's one of the things that we see about this way of repaying evil with kindness. Now, let me say something else that we'll talk about a whole lot more next week. This passage is basically saying in Romans chapter 12, don't return violence for violence. Don't return evil for evil. What this passage is not saying, both in Romans and in Matthew, when it says turn the other cheek, what it's not saying is that you can't defend yourself. What it's not saying is that you can't flee violence and sometimes should flee violence. In fact, this phrase, burning coals upon your head, that comes out of Romans 12, verse 20, it's actually a quote from the Old Testament in Proverbs chapter 25. And most of the time, when that phrase is used, it's not about returning, it's not about seeing the person broken down and repenting, humbled by your kindness. It's actually about bringing punishment on the person. In other words, you can also turn this person, instead of repaying evil with evil, you can turn this person over to God for judgment, either through the appointed authorities that he has, or on the very last day when God will execute judgment. In fact, the ESV Study Bible, which I continue to highly recommend as a great Bible study tool, has a very helpful phrase on this passage in Matthew 5, where Jesus speaks about going the second mile and turning the other cheek. And their phrase is this: acting in love toward an attacker will often include taking steps to prevent him from further attacks. Acting in love toward an attacker will often include taking steps to prevent him from further attacks. So again, we're going to talk more about that side of things next week. But I would say this, there are two twin ditches that we're trying to avoid. The ditch of vengeance and the ditch of enabling. And both of these passages, Romans 12 and Romans 13, help us navigate between these two ditches of either taking vengeance, repaying evil with evil, or enabling, not doing anything at all about evil. So again, back to our main idea here, grace makes room for love to overcome injustice. It helps us do that by reflecting God, by repaying evil with kindness. Well, how does it do it? Specifically, practically, how do I repay evil with kindness? Well, again, our Bible helps us out here. Let's just keep reading in Matthew 5. You heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Here's a very practical thing that we can do. When Romans 12 says, don't curse, but bless, how do we bless? Pray for our enemies. Now, I'll give you a simple example of that. Not that long ago, I was interacting with someone, and I had been talking to this person about a very strained relationship for quite some time. They said they were over it, they said they had dealt with it, but they were just wisely keeping their distance lest things get flared up. Well, I knew this individual pretty well, and I asked them at one point, do you think you hate this person in your heart? And they instinctively said no. Again, first responses aren't always right responses. And then I was prompted to ask a follow-up question. I said, well, are you praying for this person? Have you prayed for this person in the last 9 months at all? And they said, no, they hadn't. And I think it's very, very difficult when you're angry at someone for a long time, resent with someone for a long time, feel constantly opposed by someone for a long time, see someone as a persistent enemy, to actually pray for them with any level of seriousness and frequently. But that's what Jesus invites us to do here. In fact, in verse 45 and 48, listen to what he says. Do this so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven, for he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust. Verse 38, you therefore must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. Essentially, Jesus is saying, look, this is how we respond because this is how our Father responds. I'm reminded of the way little kids mimic their parents. They sometimes want to dress like them. They want to help them do things. They want to copy them in every way. That's the idea here. Look, you're so in love with your father, you're so awed by him that you want to mimic and do everything that he does. That's what Jesus is saying here. This is what God does to his enemies. He blesses them. In fact, he causes the rain to fall on the just and the unjust alike. I've returned to this verse many, many times in my life when I'm dealing with situations I don't like. And it's made me ask this question. What does it mean to rain on my enemies? R-A-I-N, not rain over them, but to rain on them. God causes rain that causes life to come up and prosper. He sends that not only on the just, but also on the unjust. So I think it helps me, the way I ponder this is I say, okay, more than just praying for this person, as I'm praying for them, I'm asking the Lord, Lord, is there any way you want me to be a source of rain in their life? Is there any way that I can contribute to their life, improve their life circumstances in some ways, even if they don't change, even if they continue to be my enemy and oppose me? I think if we want proof that we belong to God, that Jesus is our Savior, that he's the King of our hearts, I would say this: watch us respond to those who oppose us. If you want proof that we belong to God, watch how we respond to those who oppose us. Watch how we respond to those who oppress us. Watch how we respond to those who threaten our lives, or something even less than our lives. Watch how we respond to those who threaten our lifestyle. If you want proof that we belong to God, that's what we need to look at. I would encourage us to look at one more verse here, verses 46 and 47 of Matthew 5. If you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? If you greet only your brothers, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? This is another way of saying the same thing. It's another way of simply saying, look, if you belong to God, watch how we respond to those who oppose us. Otherwise, we're just like every other person that does not have the Spirit of God in their life and doesn't belong to God. We just simply love those who are like us. I want to take us back to an interesting phrase here, kind of a last little run at this. Jesus says, "You have heard that it was said." He says it several times. In verse 43, he says, "You've heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy." You know what's interesting? The Bible nowhere says to hate our enemy. That was actually a common religious thought of Jesus' day. And so it made me ask the question, what are you hearing said? What are we hearing said? How are we being reprogrammed instead of being, as Romans 12, 1 and 2 says, transformed? How are we being squeezed into the world's mold? How are we hearing what is out there in popular culture and not really hearing what Jesus is saying? I think this teaching of Jesus and this teaching in Romans chapter 12, honestly, is ridiculous to non-Christians and therefore tends to be somewhat ridiculous even to Christians. I think people see this teaching as dangerous. We're going to talk a little bit more about that next week too. But I just came up with a few ideas of what are we hearing said that's different than this. So here's my sort of attempt at that. Love your neighbor who looks and thinks and lives like you do, and politely ignore being rude. Politely ignore the neighbor that's being rude to you, that's making you feel uncomfortable, that looks and believes different than you do. You've heard it said, love your coworker who agrees with you, especially the one who has the same complaint as you do. And throw under the bus your boss who doesn't give you respect or the opportunities that you rightfully deserve, or the coworker who irritates you. You've heard it said, love those who are nice to you and who support you. but and sue and protect and protest and shame through social media those who attack you or your way of life. I think the list could go on and on from there. But the whole idea that we're saying again and again here is this, that grace makes room for love to overcome injustice. It repays evil with kindness. Think of the example of the Philippian jailer. Here were Paul and Silas. They were publicly beaten. They were publicly humiliated. They were thrown in jail. The jailer was part of the corrupt system that did this to him. And when an earthquake came and all the other prisoners took off, Paul and Silas stayed there. The jailer didn't see them. He thought they were gone too. He wanted to take his life. And so what do Paul and Silas do? They stay in the jail because that was the right thing to do for them at the time. And then secondly, they cry out to the Philippian jailer and they tell him, don't kill yourself. And what happens to the Philippian jailer? Well, burning coals came on his head, so to speak. And he says to Paul and Silas, after this incredible act of kindness to the person who was part of the unjust system, he says, sirs, what must I do to be saved? So it's the example of the Philippian jailer. It is the promise of 1 Peter 2, 11 and 12. Dear friends, I urge you as temporary residents and foreigners to keep away from worldly desires that wage war against your very souls. Be careful to live properly among your unbelieving neighbors. Then, even if they accuse you of doing wrong, they will see your honorable behavior, the repaying kindness. They will see that honorable behavior, and guess what? They themselves will give honor to God when he judges the world. Your honorable behavior will have a converting power as opposed to perpetuating evil. And then we saw it when we went through Romans chapter 5. Where sin increased, grace abounded all the more. Let me put it this way. Is it not true that a Christian is living proof that when you make room for love, it can overcome injustice? Do you know justice is not God's first response to humanity? It's not his first response to his enemies. His first response is compassion. And then repeatedly, over and over again, it's outstretched arms of grace. It's patience, or another word for it, it's long suffering. So to sum things up, grace makes room for love to overcome injustice by keeping me low. It tells me not to mistrust my first instincts. It tells me to cool down. It tells me to get right vertically before I make any move horizontally. It keeps me low. Secondly, it makes room for love to overcome injustice by keeping me from playing God. It shows me repeatedly that I'm incapable of being judge, jury, and executioner. And it makes room for love to overcome injustice by providing opportunities for me to display God. I want to end with this great quote. It comes from a document by an organization called the Gospel Coalition. It says, "We meet our neighbors as we work for their peace, security, and well-being, loving them in word and deed. If we do this, we will be salt and light in the world, sustaining and improving living conditions, showing the world the glory of God by our patterns of living." Goes on to say, "As the Jewish exiles were called to love and work for the peace of Babylon, Christians too are God's people in exile." Listen to this statement. "The citizens of God's city should be the best possible citizens of their earthly city. We are neither overly optimistic nor pessimistic about our cultural influence, for we know that as we walk in the steps of the one who laid down his life for his opponents, we will receive persecution even while having social impact." So I am going to send you home with some discussion questions that might help you keep this message going a little bit more. Questions to kick around. Who are my enemies? Who are my enemies? Who are those who are hard to live peaceably with? And how can I reign on their life? Let me pray. We're so thankful, Father, for your goodness. You responded to us, your enemies, not with justice, but with mercy first, and mercy for a long time. Would you help us be like you? Would you help us repay evil with kindness? Show us who our enemies are, that we might know how to reign on them. For Jesus' sake we pray, amen.
So Red Cedar Church, in just a moment, I'm gonna send us out with a benediction, but before I do, I have a couple announcements for you. First, Tuesday prayer time is continuing. Please join us at noon if you're able. This Tuesday, it's an open invite. We'd love for you to come and pray with us for 30 minutes. And then I also want to remind you that right below this sermon, we have this Q&A time going on right now. Some of you have sent some questions in. Rick is going to be on there. If you click on the Red Cedar Connect button, that will take you to the video meeting where we'll have a time to talk through and think through what this passage means for us. So now, Red Cedar, I want to send you out with a passage right before that 1 Peter passage about the way that we live among outsiders. It comes from 1 Peter chapter 2. It says this: "You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. So may we walk in that mercy and that grace this week." And all God's people said, amen.